How are you, Andrew?
Oh, great, great. Yeah, thank you for inviting me. This is exciting.
You're welcome.
Somebody invited me somewhere. Oh my God.
Welcome on Simply Vintage Watches. Well, this watch is going to be on your channel as well on Quartz Crisis, so I guess people will get to watch it on both. But thanks for accepting the invite.
Oh, thanks for inviting me. Yeah, hopefully it's going to be interesting. Yeah, guys, don't drop out just yet. We're going to see a lot. You're going to see a lot of interesting watches. And yeah, hopefully we're going to start strong with something interesting that you don't drop out.
First of all, what are you wearing this morning, Andrew?
So I'm wearing, that's actually a good one to start with. It's Hamilton FAPD, famous military watch. But let me hear what you wear.
I
saw something interesting. Uh-huh.
It's a
very, very
from
cool.
1969 with the Lemania 1277 movement.
that works like really good. Yeah, I love it. Yeah, absolutely love it. Yeah.
Well, why don't we start with that watch you're wearing? I have your watches.
Sure. So I can.
Go ahead.
Awesome. So I can talk a little bit, kind of like how I collect, and I'm gonna show kind of like watches one by one, and like why I have this collection of watches. Like how does it make any sense? So basically, I have kind of like four watches that used to be two. Like if you see my old state of the collection, it used to be two. Now there are like four watches that I wear the most, and Hamilton FAPD is one of them, and kind of like the rest. So so Hamilton FAPD is absolutely amazing watch. So I'm gonna make a video review of it. I don't know how I still didn't do a video review, but it's American military watch. It was issued in 1970s. It's very, very rare military watch. So all of them say on the back it has these military markings. They don't just say 1970s. I think they say the same month. I think it was September. All of them are made in September 1970. Technically made in September 1970s, and they are as rare as milsubs. So not that many people know about them, but they are like super, super wearable. Obviously they have these like solid bars. So this is open-ended strap that works with solid bars, but yeah, you can wear it on all kinds of nylon straps. 36 millimeters, perfect size, which like if you collect American military watches, that's like everything is 33.5 or less. So all American military watches are very, very small. So there are only few that are larger than that. So there is this one, but this one is super rare. There is this like Benrus type one, type two, and there is like a few others, but it's very, very hard to find something like this. And so that was issued to navigators. I don't know if I'm talking too much about it. So this was issued to navigators, and because of that, this has, compared to other military watches, it has this anti-magnetic cage. Also, it's super accurate. It's the same as other navigator watches like Mark 11 or like a German Biur. After my watchmaker serviced it, it gained 33 seconds in 1 month. So not a day, a month. Yeah, it's like this is a crazy accurate.
It keeps great time.
Yeah. It's amazing watch. Yeah, absolutely love it. Yeah, this definitely deserves the review. Is way over.
I like all the details you just brought up, and that's what it's about, you know, bringing out the details, the history, and just nerd out a little bit on the watches and talk about why you appreciate it so much. And I'm sure people are going to love it as well. Great watch.
Yes. Thank you.
So what about we talk about another watch? You said you had four that you mainly wear in your rotation.
Yeah.
You have more watches.
Yeah.
What about another one?
Sure. Okay. So let's be on the military theme. So I'm going to show you one more military watch. I can put it over here. So, and let me talk a little bit about how I collect. So basically, The different ways how like people collect, for example, I know you like patterns, right? So you collect watches that are historically significant and they have some like historical significant patent. So in my case, I love everything, right? But I'm trying to collect only watches that I wear. So the only purpose for me, despite that I love many things, is to have watches that I will be wearing every day. So you will see a pretty not that large collection, but that's something that I wear all the time. And this is another like I absolutely love this watch. So this is Seiko RAF Gen 1. So this one is also was issued to British RAF pilots in 1980s, but they still kind of they still are used by maybe not now, but there is one famous picture where the person is using it during a war in Baghdad, during the first Iraqi war. So it's kind of in a weird way that they're still, I mean, maybe not now, but they were still used for kind of a long time. And yeah, this has a first Seiko quartz chronograph movement. So this has legendary, that movement is like 15 jewel, like fully all
we'll
made
put
of
a
metal.
Picture up, Andrew, because it's worth
yeah.
It. We'll put a picture up.
This is like such a cool watch. So I had it for a while. I wear it often. And over here, it's actually on MOD strap. So this strap was issued to the person who worked on nuclear submarine, not RAF pilot, but actually he worked on nuclear submarine. So that's kind of a lot of them were issued like that. Some of them were issued on that boom strap that Warden is talking about, but that this was also very, very common how they were issued. And the cool thing about both military watches that I showed is it's not something like you couldn't buy them, right? It's not like so they were specifically designed and made by a brand for either like this one is for MOD, the previous one was for American military, specifically for navigators. They didn't buy some like civilian models. That was like that's the one made specifically for military, and you had to be actually serving in the military to get watch like that. Love it.
Perfect. So we have the theme going on with the Hami. Now we have the Seiko RAF. And why not talk about the third watch in your rotation, a Tudor Black Bay 36.
Okay, so Tudor Black Bay 36. This is one of the four. So you saw two. Now this is another one. So I do wear it a lot now. The theme of collecting for me is vintage watches. So I'm not going to be buying any more modern watches. And as you see, this is a modern watch, right? So when I just started collecting, I had both modern and vintage, but I decided that I love vintage so much more. There is so much value, so much more interesting. They look cooler. Not this one, but that other ones look cool. So my goal is so I have another modern watch, but basically my goal is to have the Tudor Black Bay, the only modern watch that is left in my collection. So I will, so I actually bought it from AD. So this has a lot of kind of sentimental value. I bought apartment in Tudor City. So this is Tudor and kind of like many. So I'm going to keep it. That also was my only, so I don't have Grail watches. There's nothing that I kind of aspire to have it, but that was my only Grail watch. And that's like Grail achieved. So I will never get rid of this watch. And I wear it. It's like one of the four most worn watches. But yeah, I'm not going to have any more modern watches because, yeah, it's modern. It's not cool. send all the hate mail on Nelson's, not mine, but his channel.
Well, it's similar. I own one modern watch as well. It's somewhere behind me right here. It's the Olic and Vice P104, but the rest of my watches are all vintage watches. But yeah, we have that in common as well. But what do you like about that specific watch? What drew you to that watch?
Yeah, so again, 36 millimeters, perfect size. Now we are bombarded with all this, like everybody likes Rolex and stuff. Like I don't, but there is no way escaping from this, right? And because of that, sometimes I want to wear a Rolex, right? This has, again, while it's not a Rolex, so I can feel like I'm like a cool guy not wearing a Rolex, but it's a Rolex Oyster case, yeah, yeah, right? Yeah. It's pretty much an analog of the Rolex Explorer 1 from Tudor. It has snowflake hands. It's a cool watch. It's kind of also when I feel like, okay, like everybody bombards me how great steel sports watches are. Again, this is a perfect steel sports watch.
It's a beautiful watch. It is.
Yeah.
But when you mentioned the history, the joint history with Rolex, you can actually find it through the patents. You know, I'm a patent guy.
So, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
when C.R. Spillman purchased the patent from Perregaux and Perret, then C.R. Spillman sold the patent to Rolex. And you find Tudors in the vintage market, I think, until up to the late 70s that were still made or cased. The Oyster cases were still made by C.R. Spillman. So it's nice. Very, very, very joint, the Oyster case.
Nice.
It's a nice watch. I really, really like it.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Must wear good on our smaller wrists.
Yes. Yes. That's another. So like you will see my watches. They are 30, about like 36 millimeters. That is my perfect size plus minus few millimeters. I don't have these like larger watches. So it's like 36 millimeters, like looks good, but smaller wrist. Yeah. So that's.
Now I want to mention Andrew, a watch that I know is very important to you. And that's the 45GS.
Yeah, so
that watch.
Yeah, so a lot of people, just because my Grand Seiko videos are so popular, a lot of people think that I'm a Grand Seiko collector, which, like, I love. So like, probably my two favorite brands are Grand Seiko and Hamilton. And it's just because these brands are the best documented, right? For every single watch, you can find catalog picture. You can find high-res pictures of the watch. You can see like what's redial, what's not redial. You know, like if you look at Rolex, it's impossible. Like there's like one big mess. You look at like Omega, it's impossible. Maybe like few watches are documented, everything else is like, you don't know what dials to belongs to, like which hands, like all mess. But with these brands, it's all very, very well documented. So these are Grand Seiko and Hamilton are the best brands to collect. Again, they are also not that expensive just yet. Especially Grand Seiko is on the rise, Hamilton not yet. Oh, by the way, Grand Seiko, Hamilton.
There you go.
Absolutely. Like the, if you are talking about this 45GS, and they made several 45GSs, yeah. So this was is 8000 dial. So this one is very, very similar case, almost identical case to legendary 44GS. And like Grand Seiko is famous for grammar of design. Right, so like when people buy Grand Seiko, they want grammar of design, and that's that legendary grammar of design. It has like here over the lugs, it does everything correctly, not how they do in modern watches. And this is just perfect, just like perfect watch designed by Taro Tanaka. Like it's kind of like his original design. The bracelet is from a different Grand Seiko special that was made about 5 years after, but it's I wear it on straps. It looks great on straps, great on Grand Seiko vintage Grand Seiko bracelet. It's amazing everyday piece.
The angles on that case are beautiful. I've not seen one in the flesh, but the angles on that case are really, really sharp, crisp, and very specific. You can't mistake that Grand Seiko case. It's beautiful.
Yeah, that's something that Swiss didn't do, and that's something that Japanese, they kind of improved on these like boring Swiss cases. Like that case is very, very hard to do. So that's why they talk about the Zaratsu. There is a lot of manual labor, but yeah, these lines, like you almost, it looks like I can cut myself, you know. So some of them are over polished, so you should look for it. But if the watch wasn't polished, then yeah, this is so, like, it plays with light. It's
that one still, it's just looks sharp from here, from a distance. It looks sharp.
Yeah. So that's the yeah. Like, few of them are ruined because people liked to polish their watches. Still, it's not as common as like with Rolexes or just yeah. Like, when you're buying, just make sure your watch wasn't polished. But yeah, this is so, this it's absolutely amazing. Yeah.
Amazing. Thanks for sharing that watch, Andrew.
Thank you. So
to the other group of watches. We have five other watches that maybe you wear less, but are dear to you as well. They're in your collection. They're still in your rotation, and they're there for a reason. So what about you show us a quirky watch? And I think it's from the 80s, right? The Casio Databank.
Oh, yeah. Casio. Yeah. And we can actually talk about another. Oh, hold on. It's not here. Okay.
I'll post the picture up.
But
he has a nice
but yeah, so bag. Yeah, let's put it. I forgot, it's not in this, it's over there. But anyway, so let me talk a little, because there is another very, very important principles kind of how I collect. So I think that I should wear my most expensive watches the most, right? So it's kind of like wear per dollar, right? So if I buy something expensive, kind of like this one, I should target that I will wear it a lot. Now it happens that right now market prices for these Casio databanks, again, like people hate digital watches right now. People hate anything with battery. People hate anything LCD. So that's why even like one of the coolest LCD watches, like that databank, it's like absolutely amazing watch. This is like the first databank that Casio created. Like you look how it looks. This is just like unbelievable look, you know, and they still, again, it's like well below 1,000, you know, it's like few hundred bucks, right? So I that's actually not so my wife just gave me this watch, so that's not this watch. But
is
that's
that
the Luminor? Watch on the picture. No, that's Casio A168, very cool watch. That's from her collection.
I'll post her data bank up. It's in very,
yeah, yeah,
very
but like, look at that picture. This is like, this is like somebody will see this watch, it's like wow. But again, so I wear that watch less, and that kind of goes with my principles. So it costs less, and I'm allowed to wear it less, right? But if I would buy something like that, and it would be like the most expensive watch in my collection, and I would be like wear it occasionally for the special event, that goes against my principles, right? So that's how.
It's a logical way to collect. Pretty reasonable. It's logical.
that's kind of how. Yeah.
So what about that nice vintage Movado Kingmatic? I saw that in a pic, Andrew. I fell in love with the dial.
Yeah. So that one is. That one is also very, very cool. So it has a cool story. It has some connection to Grand Seiko, because if you look at Grand Seiko first, so that's actually what they tried to copy. They tried to copy this watch, right? And again, they didn't try to specifically copy Movado. There are Omegas that look like that. That was Swiss watch from 60s. So first Japanese tried to copy what Swiss do well. And after that, they went for their crazy grammar of design. So they exceeded this, right? So they made the watch that's just better than this one. But like if you would look at Grand Seiko first, this has cooler dial. This has this very, very cool engine turned dial. It has this like engine turned square, that's actually what Movado did. Movado was a very, very high end company at that time, and that's how they did it. It looks really nice. One thing why this watch is not one of top four is, unfortunately, it's gold plated. you know, and like
the wear. It doesn't look like too much.
Yeah. No. I'm just like, I know this. I know it's like wearing a, like it's not a fake, right? But it's like, I'm trying to show that it's a gold watch, but it's not a gold watch. And it hurts. I know this is something stupid for me, but yeah. So that's the only reason why I wear it less. My wife loves it. And it also has a very cool story. So I traded this watch. So I went to concert of jazz musician here in Harlem, Bill Saxton, and he was performing with this watch. So that was his watch. And at the end, we kind of like talked, and we decided to trade watches. Mm-hmm. So that's the watch that he gave me. I serviced it. It's pretty accurate, and it has 28. Like at that time, this was super super high end watch, and they made it in solid gold also. But they like. Every company, they made it stainless steel, gold plated, and solid gold. So this is gold plated
too, Andrew. So it's a unique watch. Mm-hmm. I mean, he handed it to you. There was a real trade going on one-on-one.
Yeah,
it was Bill Saxton's watch. He wore it on concert. That's a great backstory as well for you.
Yeah. So that's kind of has a big sentimental value. This watch never goes away from my collection, and I do wear it. I do wear it just not as often as other watches, just because I know for some reason this like the fact that it's gold. It probably has solid gold dial, because you can't do engine turning, and after that gold plated, after that it will look like crap. So the dial is probably solid gold, but the case is gold plated. So that's kind of
it's a beautiful watch nonetheless.
Cool.
It's a great looking watch, and it's true that in the vintage market, I've seen beautiful Movados, a lot of value for money. They made triple calendars. At a certain point, their parts were being shared, and this is well documented, shared between them and Patek Philippe and other watchmakers. You see the triple calendars, their indices, the hands, the dials, they're all exactly the same, the type of lugs. So Movado used to make beautiful watches in the vintage.
I almost started hunting those triple calendars some time ago, but I... So the only reason why I stopped, I'm gonna mention this. So I got this super rare solid gold Bonklip bracelet, and it's 18 millimeters. And I cannot. I think Movado did not. Anyway, if I'm wrong, let me know. I think Movado did not make a waterproof triple calendar watch that would be both 18 millimeters and waterproof. So they made either 18 millimeters but not waterproof, or 16 millimeters but waterproof in this like Francois Bergel case. But no Francois Bergel case and 18 millimeters. So that's why I stopped hunting them. But yeah, you can get a triple calendar solid gold like slightly about like $1,000, and again, so like if you think about how much value is there, this is crazy. Like even if you pay like 2,000, this is like, and they're easy to service. That's another thing. I talked to my watchmaker. He says they just added a few parts. It's very easy to service. But I stopped hunting them. So that's why you should hunt them.
I'll do the research for you. That's cool.
They're amazing. Amazing watches, yeah.
So we'll move on to another watch. Why not? The legendary SKX. The SKX.
Yeah, so let's let me talk about SKX. So SKX is second modern watch success. Yeah, I have only two in my collection, and I'm working on replacing it with a vintage watch. So my goal is to have only Tudor, this serves a purpose, and it serves very. So first of all, the watch is cool, right? This is legendary watch. They discontinued, pretty cool. It's just modern. The purpose that it's serving is if I go swimming or like snorkeling, and I hope maybe I will spend more time like in Florida, I'm swimming with this watch. It's larger. It's 42 millimeters. It looks kind of like a hockey puck on my wrist, but it's okay. So like, yeah, it's okay. Like for if I'm in the context of swimming or like I'm on a beach, that looks good to have this giant monstrosity on your wrist, because it's dive watch, right? So my goal is like, I absolutely love this design. This like this there's nothing wrong with this this watch. I just want to replace it with vintage watch, you'll show a picture. So I'm replacing it with his granddaddy, the watch that looks almost the same, 700. So my goal is, so I already purchased that watch, 7002, that you see in the picture. It's in service, and service in Seiko, Grand Seiko in USA, it's very, very difficult. All these watchmakers that can do Seiko, they are overbooked. So I've sent it for service. My 7002, I've sent it for service.
You want to waterproof that watch, right? You want to waterproof.
Oh, yeah. So I want to service it, waterproof it, test it to, I don't know, I'd like 200 meters, but at least like something reasonable that I can swim with it. But it's still in service. It's about 1 year and it's still in service. So yeah, the Seiko watchmakers, it's a dire problem here in the United States, not in other countries, but in the United States, it's very difficult. But yeah, until my 7002 comes, I will keep wearing this watch. And with 7002, it's going to be very interesting experiment. Can I actually swim and use vintage watch as kind of like the everyday swimming watch? So Seiko SKX.
You'll be happy when you receive the 7002 as well.
So I hope so, yeah.
To a next watch, and that's the Hamilton Gilbert.
Yeah, so now, so we are kind of coming to gold, solid gold.
the theme,
yeah. Maybe a year or a little bit more ago, I kind of was thinking where I want to go with my collecting. And I decided that I wanna, so again, like I'm not gonna sell everything and rebuy something what I want, but my long-term strategy is to own only solid gold or military. So why solid gold? Again, because everybody likes stainless steel. because everybody likes stainless steel, I like solid gold, and especially yellow solid gold. Yeah. So first of all, I can't because everybody bombards you how to use stainless steel. You see it like everywhere, right? So I want to learn for myself how to wear gold, right? Right. Like what it looks good, how to like what outfits work. Like a lot of solid gold watches are dress watches. So you can either wear dress watches casually, or you can find some, there are some solid gold watches that are more like casual or even like sports solid gold watches. Again, I'm trying to avoid Rolex because this is, the good thing about solid gold is that these solid gold was always top products of the brand, like sure. Take Rolex, best watches that Rolex thinks are best watches are made in solid gold. You take, I don't know, like Hamilton or like Patek, the best watches that these brands made were in solid gold. And this kind of like cheap crap, whatever they do, like these like Nautiluses, that's that's kind of like the, everybody pays a lot for them, yeah. But they themselves don't consider it the best. They consider it that kind of like on the bottom scale of that. So when I'm buying solid gold right now, I'm buying top watches of the brand, and I'm paying like very, very, very little, because like everybody hates them right now. So with Gilbert. So I had very, very similar caster that I absolutely loved it, but I sold caster and I bought Gilbert only because Gilbert fits my legendary solid gold Bonklip bracelet. By the way, these bracelets, they are like, I saw three in my life. They are very, very rare. So it's easy to find stainless steel or like plated bracelet, but solid gold is like 9 karat solid gold British bone clips. They are like super, super rare. So I'm glad I was able to buy this. So right now I wear my Gilbert on a bone clip, but I hope maybe I will add more to my collection, 18 millimeter solid gold watches. I will wear with my super cool Bonklip.
I think that's a great idea to own an American-made vintage watch, especially when they were on top of their game, when they were making completely in-house movement, cases, dials, indices, hands, whatever you want to call it, everything
like rubies made by Hamilton, oils made by Hamilton, like mainsprings.
Even the mainsprings,
like
exactly.
Absolutely.
So it's a great piece of history. I think it's a great idea to own one of those watches. Very good choice.
Yeah, I always say, guys, American-made watches, like, again, like Hamilton was the top brand at that time, but like any American brands, like nobody wants them. They are like super cheap and super, super cool. Like they are so, so cool. It's just, impossible to ignore this. There are many more cool watches. Hopefully I will add to my collection.
And I think you have one more, Andrew, to share with us.
And let me see. Yes. So my
watch.
My last one. So,
So I actually have, so like the collection that I've just seen today, shown today, it's kind of like what I wear every day, but I actually have another collection that I don't wear. And that collection is a collection of Soviet watches. So this is basically family watches, right? So like if there is a watch that my father wore and he gave me, right, I'm not gonna just sell it because I don't wear it, right? So I'm gonna keep it. So I have like similar size collection of Soviet watches. From time to time, one or two of these watches come to my main collection, kind of like this one. I a little bit wear it, they go back, and maybe I'll pick another watch, I wear it. So this one I actually wear often. So this is Chaika. It's pretty, like it's not a monstrosity like SKX, but it's large watch. It looks good, like because it's Soviet, it's gold plated, obviously. But it's So this was worn by, this was owned by my wife's grandpa. So this was the watch that he was wearing, and we found it. I love it. It's super, super cool. What there are a lot of Soviet brands. Chaika is more known for women's watches. They made these like smallest. They beat some like world records and stuff. But they made few men's watches. Like people don't, again, like people don't know Soviet watches at all. But like people who know Soviet watches, they are surprised that Chaika made some men's watches. And pretty much all the men's watches that they made, they are kind of cool in some way.
Have a pusher around 8 o'clock?
It has. So you advance. So this is day date, right? So you advance date by pressing this pusher. And you advance the day, but by doing this, some watches have you move past 12, and after that you go back a few hours and you bring it back. Yeah, so that's how you're supposed to change day, but date you just press the pusher, and it's super, super convenient. I actually love it. Very, very cool watch.
Well, it's good that piece is with you. It's sort of a family heirloom, right? So it's good.
So. So that's pretty much my collection. kind of like big four watches that I wear like mostly, but also these the few other watches that I wear kind of like from time to time. I enjoy vintage watches.
Because it's basically Andrew's state of the collection. At the same we start a new segment on Simply Vintage Watches called the Collector's Conversation. So this is my
and
first
I'm the very first guest. Thank you for the honor.
You're welcome, yeah. Andrew. You're welcome anytime. So I'll see you next time, Andrew.
Thank you for inviting. And guys, if you watch it on my channel, that please press over here and check out Nelson's channel about vintage watches. Especially check out his video Oyster Perpetual Lies, and I hope it's gonna become serious. And if you watch it on Nelson's channel, then again, like press the same thing, and you're gonna visit my channel.
See you next time, guys. Thanks for joining us.
Okay, bye.
Ciao. Bye.